following police interview is from the 14th of the 5th, 96. This interview is being tape recorded. The time is now 12:34 hours. The date is the 14th of the 5th, 96. We're in an interview room within the custody area at the Grays Police Station in Essex. My name is Tim Willis. I'm a Detective Sergeant, Collar Number 68, stationed at Police Headquarters. The other officer present is Detective Constable 2034 Myhill, also stationed at Headquarters Central Detective Unit. And we're interviewing the name, please, Jack. Jack Arthur Womes. And your address? Brockford. Also present is your legal representative, Paul Roach, solicitor. I shall remind you, Jack, that whilst you're here, you have the right of free legal advice. Your solicitor sits here with you. If at any time during the interview you feel you need to speak to your solicitor in private, let us know. And you've had a couple of hours this morning with him already, but if you feel you need to speak to him again, let us know. And obviously, you're not going to too much frustrate our interviewing process, then we'll allow whatever time we can for that. Thank you very much. I just want to tell you that you do not have to say anything, but it may harm your defence if you do not mention when questioned something that you are later relying on in court. Anything you do say may be given in evidence. Do you understand that? Yes. So that's what we call the caution. Right, earlier on this morning, Jack, we gave your solicitor, Mr. Roach, what we call a briefing note as regards to the interview that is going to take place today, alright? Now I'll show you that. I think I should at this stage make comment about the fact that this has been provided. Okay. I have read this through to Jack. You know, I've made some representations to the custody sergeant concerning Jack's lack of reading skills. He's, I think he's dyslexic. He clearly has great difficulty reading. I've read this through to him and I've chosen to deal with it quite logically in two parts. And because that's the way that was intended by yourselves when you drafted this. Now, as I understand it, Jack is, I've tried to explain the caution to him. He's going to make some comment today, as I understand. And he's going to be fully denying both offences if we deal with it as two offences. Fully deny any involvement with these offences whatsoever. Saying that, as I've expressed to you that you've heard he's dyslexic, and you'll note for yourselves that he's got a lack of conversational skills. I can't default that. Do you feel alright today, Jack?
Yeah, I feel fine.
You do, because your voice doesn't sound like it did in the previous interviews to me, actually, at the moment. Right. Okay, there was no comment in the other interviews. Okay, we'll forget that. I'm now going to read a notice that was given to Mr. Roach earlier this morning, headed Solicitor's Briefing Notes, Interviews. All right, Jack, I want you to pay special attention to this. The interview is as follows. The police have information that between the 1st 11th 95 and the 21st 11th 95, the following persons and others conspired to import controlled drugs, namely cannabis resin, to the United Kingdom. These persons are Michael Steele, your good self, Peter Corey, Darren Nichols, Patrick Tate, Anthony Tucker, and Craig Rolfe. Okay, for the benefit of the tape, Jack nodded his head in agreement there. Can I just say, Jack, that, oh yeah, I agree with what you just said. Thank you. Right, there is information to suggest that once imported and distributed, it was found that at the least part of this consignment was very poor quality, and the result part of it was returned and a refund was demanded. This brought about a breakdown in relationships between some of the named above, as the drugs had to be returned and there was the loss of face and credibility within the group. There was also information that some of those involved in the conspiracy travelled to Ostend. They were handed a cash refund for the poor quality drugs, okay?
Yes, I heard what you said.
You heard what I said?
Yeah.
Is there anything in there that you don't understand? I'm not saying I'm asking you to agree with what's been put down there. I'm just saying, is there anything there that you do not understand?
No, but finish it and read it again. And I've got it again.
Okay, that was the information. Our intent was to ask you, Jack, questions in relation to the part that you played in this particular importation. We intend to ask questions relating to your movements, Jack, actions, associates and contacts, either personally, face-to-face, or by telephone. Okay, that is what we're going to ask you about. We're going to ask you what your role was in the importation, your movements on certain days and dates, what you did on certain days and dates, and your associates throughout the whole of that period between the 1st 11th 95 and the 21st 11th 95. And as I said, that's either by face-to-face
or by the phone, okay? Okay, yeah. You understand that? I understand now you've broke it down a bit. Good. Sorry. The second information on that same sheet refers to the 7th of the 12th, 95, when three people that were mentioned earlier, Tony Tucker, Patrick Tate and Craig Rolfe, were found in a Range Rover in a secluded lane in Retterden, Essex. All three had died of shotgun wounds. And information suggests Michael Steele, yourself Jack, and Darren Nichols were all there or near the scene of the murders at that material time. That's what the time when we think it happened. And at that material time, the three men murdered were arranged to meet Michael Steele. In addition, Nichols, since his arrest, has given accounts of events on the 6th of December 95, the day before the bodies were found. He has given an account of events on the 6th of December 95, which directly implicates Michael Steele and yourself in the murders. Do you understand that?
Yes, I think I understand it.
Do you understand what implicate means? In its loosest terms, basically then, to save you, Mr. Nichols, in layman's terms, is pointing the finger at you, Jack.
Yeah.
And at Michael Steele.
Yeah.
Of all being responsible of the murders of Tony Tucker, Pat Tate and Craig Rolfe. Do you understand that?
I understand. Good. Implication, yeah?
Good.
Yeah.
Yes. I'm not suggesting that you're agreeing with what I've said, but just that you understand what I've said.
Implication, yeah.
Our intention then is to ask you questions relating to your part in these murders. We're going to ask you questions relating to, again, your actions and movements at material times. Your associates, once again, and contacts with people, once again, either personally, face-to-face, or by the telephone, okay?
Okay.
Now, you do understand that.
I understand that.
Do you want me to read in that sheet again?
No, I think I've got that.
Right, we're going to do referring to a statement. What I will say, it's not a statement that has been served at this stage. It's one of literally hundreds of statements that have been taken, all of which are contained within a home's computer, which is in the Home Office large major inquiry computer. It's a statement of Donalyn Jaggers, age 26. How do you spell that?
Jaggers.
And the Donalyn?
Donna.
All right, I'm sorry. And the Lynn?
Lynn.
This is statement number 142A from the computer, which is probably the nearest to an identified mark, but is made by Donalyn Jaggers. And it's not the only statement that she's made. Do you know someone called Donna Jaggers? As I say, we haven't any sight of this. You're free to answer all the questions. If you at any time want to interrupt this and have a private consultation with me, then so be it. And if you choose not to make a no comment at any stage because you haven't seen it, then so be it.
Yeah, no comment.
Donna Jaggers was the common law wife of Craig Rolfe. Craig Rolfe, as we've already discussed, is one of the people that was murdered between the 6th and the 7th of December 95. I think what I'm going to do is read straight lifts from the statement, then ask you a question around the content of this statement, so I can quote here from the statement now. I learnt from Craig that a person called Mickey the Pilot, who I know to be called Mickey Steele, was a friend of Patrick Tate, who in turn was a friend of Tony Tucker. Now, coming out of that statement, Patrick Tate and Tony Tucker are the other two victims of the murder on the 6th or the 7th of December. Steele, I understood to be a pilot who brought drugs into the country, and as I understood, that he'd been in prison for it. Do you know Michael Steele?
No comment.
Craig told me that Steele was a ruthless person who really didn't think very much of other people. Would you describe Michael Steele as a ruthless person?
No comment.
I've moved on a couple of pages of the statement now, and should I point out the date of the statement really, which is the 14th of the 3rd, 96. Steele Jaggers? It's the same statement.
Same statement.
Yeah, the date, the statement I've been referring to, was made on the 14th of the 3rd, some 2 months ago.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Right, okay, I'm quoting from it. The last deal which Steele carried out for them was approximately 2 weeks after Tate was released from prison, which was at the end of October 95. End of quote. Do you understand that? 2 weeks after who was released?
Tate.
Tate was released from prison on the October 95.
I understand.
Right. Craig told me that Mickey Steele was arranging to bring in £60,000 worth of cannabis from abroad. Craig put in £7,000, Tucker put in £20,000, and Tate and a fourth person called Barry Dorman was putting in the remainder of the money. Do you understand that?
I think I understand, yeah.
A couple of days before the cannabis was collected, I went with Craig to Tucker's home address in Fobbing, Essex, to hand him the £7,000. Then it carries on, and later on, a line or two later, the money was handed to Tucker, who in turn was going to hand it to Steele. We was only at the house for about 5 minutes, and as Craig as I was leaving and walking down the driveway towards our car, I saw Mickey Steele walking up the driveway towards the house. He passed us by and nodded to Craig. He did not speak or acknowledge myself. Steele had come from a white car. He carries on, and jumping down a line or two, there was a second male in the car who had short dark hair and appeared to be a little younger than Steele. He appeared clean shaven, but I did not take any further notice. Do you understand that?
I understand what you're reading, yes, right.
Jumping forward again in the statements a few lines, a couple of days later, Craig told me that Steele had been arrested by customs officers while he was taking his boat from the water. This was following him dropping the cannabis off at a safe point on the coastline about 3 miles away. Do you understand that?
Yeah, I hear what you say.
That same day, Pat was arrested during the early afternoon, having crashed Tucker's Porsche in Southend. Craig had picked me up from work and told me what had happened to Steele. Do you understand that?
I understand.
And I can tell you that that day, Tate was arrested in Southend was the 8th. He was certainly in custody during the, I believe it was the 8th at 11:95. Is it right that you was also arrested yourself about the same time by customs officers?
No comment.
Do you deny that he was arrested at that time by customs officers?
No comment.
Is it right that at 4:25 on the 8th of 11th 95 that he was arrested at Felixstowe in the company of Mickey Steele and a man called Corey? I would argue that this is prejudice, but I'll leave that for a later date at this stage.
Yeah, right. Do you agree that he was arrested at 4:25 with Mr. Steele and Mr. Corey at Felixstowe by customs officers?
No comment.
Well, that just puts this statement in context, that's all. So I've just read from that statement, I'm going to go back over it. A couple of days later, Craig told me that Steele had been arrested by customs officers while I was taking his boat from the water.
This was following him dropping the cannabis off at a safe point on the coastline about 3 miles away. That same day, Tate was arrested during the early afternoon, having crashed Tucker's Porsche in Southend. So going back over it, when it comes down to the same day, you was arrested by customs officers. Tate, Mr. Tate was in custody at Southend for an offence, I think, of drink driving.
Yes.
Craig picked me up from work and told me what had happened to Steele. About 4 p.m, Tucker phoned Craig on his mobile phone and told him that his car and what Tate had done to it. Tate crashed Tucker's car, leading up to his arrest. About 6 p.m, that day, Craig and I drove to Southend Police Station to collect Tate. Coming out of that statement was that Pat was then upon his release from custody by officers at Southend. He was picked up by Craig and Donna. Once in the vehicle, I became aware that Tate already knew that Steele had been arrested. He then used Craig's mobile phone to ring Jackie Steele. Now, Jackie Steele is how Donna Jaggers knows Mickey Steele's common law wife. In fact, her real name is Street. It is not Steele.
That's right, Jackie Street.
That's the person who she's referring to. He asked if everything was safe. I took it that as a result of Tate's manner and subsequently what I said to Craig, he said that everything was safe. I took this to mean that the drugs had not been found. On this occasion, I do not know where the meeting between Steele and the others was to take place, but after a couple of days, Craig brought his share of cannabis round to our house in Chavid 100. Because the cannabis had already been sold on the same day, Craig and I took it up to Golders Green area of North London, where Craig handed it to a coloured male named Gary. Do you understand the content of this statement that I'm reading?
Yeah, you're reading me someone's statement.
Do you understand what he's saying?
Roughly, yeah.
Is there anything you don't understand about it?
No, it's just going on for quite a while. It's a job to take it all in.
What's the name of the coloured man?
Gary.
Gary. No money was exchanged because the cannabis was what's known as laid on. Gary for him to sell and then pay back Craig. The agreed amount per kilo worked out to be approximately £10,000 for the lot. Coming out of the statement now, we're talking about the cannabis that was imported, we believe, and landed just prior to your arrest by customs officers on the early morning
of the 8th. It goes then, I learnt through Craig that Tate and Tucker were very adulated because Steele, during this time, was trying to push a price that he wanted up as for the cannabis that he was importing. I'm going to move back up a couple of lines now to put that last bit in context. Already the others have placed their own share with other dealers, but very quickly they've started receiving phone calls telling them that the cannabis was very poor quality. Basically, that the gear they'd bought in was a load of crap, was no good, and they were getting it back from the people they'd dealt it to. Do you understand what I mean by that? Not really, no. If I sell you something, you expect it to be of a certain quality, and if it's not of a certain quality, then you give it back and ask for a refund. Do you understand the principle of that? Yeah. What you do in the shop, yeah? Yeah. If it's gone mouldy, you give it back? Yeah. And that's what we're talking about. So again, reading from the statement, they contacted Steele and told him that they wanted their money back because the cannabis was rubbish. Do you understand that? And they being Rolf, Tucker and Tate. Do you understand that? Yeah, I understand. Steele didn't want to take it back. Tate and Tucker then started putting real pressure on Steele to recover the money. By pressure, I mean through intimidation. I cannot say exactly what they did because I do not know, but I can recall hearing conversations they had with Steele on the phone where they were ranting and raving at one another and pacing up and down. So basically, Jack, it shows a falling out between Mickey Steele and Tate, Tucker and Rolf over the cannabis that was imported on the 8th 11th 95. Do you understand the content of this statement, what I'm saying there?
I understand what you're reading, yeah.
Do you understand what I'm saying, that we believe that Tucker, Tate and Rolf were unhappy with Steele about the quality of the cannabis? Do you understand what I'm saying?
Yeah, I understand what you're saying, yeah.
Right. I understand that Steele finally agreed to return the cannabis and get the money back for them. Tate, in a fit of temper about the whole affair, smashed each slab before it was returned. Steele had told them that a parcel the same size had been picked up by mistake, and that's how the problem had come about. Do you understand that?
No.
I'm sure I don't understand that either. Right, well, my interpretation is that, Mickey Steele agreed to return the cannabis and give their money back. Right, so he took the cannabis back from Tate, Tucker and Rolf and gave them back the money from which they'd paid for it. Do you understand that?
Like taking damaged goods back to the shop?
Yeah. Steele had told them that a parcel the same size had been picked up by mistake, and that's how the problem had come about. So Steele had offered an explanation to Tate, Tucker and Rolf that he'd picked up the wrong gear, the wrong cannabis. Do you understand that?
Yeah, I think I do, yeah.
Steele arranged to hand the money back to them on the continent. He was going to return the goods to the suppliers and take the money to a prearranged location where he was going to meet Craig, Tucker and Tate. Do you understand that?
Yeah.
Right, so a meeting was arranged between Steele, Craig, Tucker and Tate. The reason she refers to Craig is obviously her deceased common-law husband. We haven't put it in the statement as Rolf, but for Craig, it's Craig Rolf. You understand that? Craig, Tucker and Tate. A meeting is arranged, she says, between Mickey Steele, Craig, Tucker and Tate on the continent to return the money for the crap cannabis. Do you understand that?
Yeah.
I think we'll jump across to that one now, shall we? And then we'll come back to this. What do you think? I just, before we go on like any further really, wanted to ask Jack, what's your relationship, if any, with Michael Steele?
No comment.
Well, you are denying, Jack, that you know Michael Steele.
No comment.
Because, and I'm sure it will be documented in court, and we certainly have enough documented piece of paper here to show telephone calls between Michael Steele, Mickey, whatever you want to call him, between him and your good self, via each other's mobiles. And also would suggest you to his home address and him to your home address, either via mobiles or via landline phones. Can you explain to me how that came about? Are you suggesting to me that this is a mistake, that there are numerous phone calls to one another's phone numbers by mistake?
No comment.
Because it would seem to me that there is a man that you was arrested with on the 8th of November on a beach near Felixstowe. And you're not really saying anything about that at all. You don't even say to me whether you know Michael Steele, but I'm suggesting to you that you do. And it may be in fear that you're not saying anything. Are you scared of him?
I mean, you're reading me stories and going on about this. And I mean, I don't really know what you're actually implying.
What are you implying?
Well, I think, tell me what you're implying.
I think what we're suggesting
And what I believe is that Michael Steele is an importer of controlled substances, drugs, cannabis, cocaine, whatever you want to call it. Mr. Steele is, as I understand, an accomplished pilot, hence no doubt his nickname, Mickey the Pilot. He is an accomplished boatman, from what I understand, and obviously has some sort of intelligence as regards to these matters. And I'm suggesting to you, Jack, that you're his right-hand man, that whatever Michael says goes, because he seems to have got some sort of hold over you, that you do whatever Michael says. Jack, go there. Jack, do this. Oh yes, Michael. And I'm suggesting to you that you were involved in an importation of controlled substances between these dates that I've read out to you earlier on. If I can just quote the, between the 1st 11th 95 and the 21st 11th 95, we are suggesting that a deal was struck between Patrick Tate, Tony Tucker and Craig Rolfe. Do you know them? No comment. Do you understand the question? Yeah, you're implied. I mean, I asked you what you're implying. You haven't finished that. No, I haven't yet. Not yet. Well, can you finish what you're implying? And I'll give you a response to it. Implying that a deal was struck between Michael Steele and yourself, Patrick Tate, Tony Tucker, Craig Rolfe, to import a substantial quantity of cannabis resin from the continent, we believe Belgium, into this country, and that you are an integral part, or perhaps, I ought to rephrase that, you are involved. Involved, thank you. Involved in a large way in the importation of that substance. I can assure you that I'm not involved. I've got nothing to do with that. Why were you on the beach at Felixstowe at 4:30 in the morning on the 8th of November? I can't really remember. It's probably a long while ago. Well, Jack, I'm sorry, mate. I mean, I don't want to be facetious, and I hope you and your solicitor won't take it, but the 4th of November is, what, 6 months ago? And I think I would have remembered if I'd have been arrested on the beach by a policeman at 4:30 in the morning. Well, you probably are being facetious. Not really. I mean, I would recall. It's up to the suspect to make his own answers. But if you're saying you can't remember is what you've said, then what we're saying to you is it seems unreasonable to me that you can't remember what you were doing at somewhat at 4 o'clock in the morning 6 months ago when you was arrested. That's what I'm saying. If you want to say that, you say that. But I've asked you what you implied, and I gave you an answer. I've got nothing to do with whatever you... But what we're asking you, Jack, is what you were doing on that beach when you was arrested at 4:30 in the morning. Well, there's no comment on that question. All right, you don't want to tell us what you were doing there. No comment on that question. Right. So you don't want to tell us who you was with on the beach at 4:30 in the morning? No comment. Did you know that traces of cannabis was found in your boat following your arrest? No comment. On that morning? No comment. Do you own, and I'm not a boatman, I have to explain it straight away, I think it's a rib. A rigid inflatable boat. Thank you. Do you own one? No comment. Because on that beach was an orange and black Yamaha Humber Autolude boat on a rib boat. Do you know what I mean by a rib boat? No comment. Because I understand that you've been seen with and refueling such a boat. No comment. Whose was the blue Range Rover on the beach that morning? The Range Rover was with the boat. He had an index number of DES36V. No comment. What motor vehicles do you own, Jack? I'm sorry, I've omitted to ask you that. No comment. Like I say, I don't know whether to take that. Do you own a motor vehicle? No comment. Do you drive? No comment. Because I believe that you have access to a blue transit van, L98YDX. Is that your van? No comment. Or does that belong to GT Commercials, who I think you work for? No comment. You're self-employed? No comment. And I believe you're a self-employed commercial engineer who has some connections with GT Commercials that have a premises in Barham. Is that correct? No comment. And I believe that van belongs to that company, which I think you have dealings with. Do you also have a blue Range Rover? No comment. Okay. Peter Corey, do you know that man? No comment. He was arrested with you on the beach as well with Michael Steele that morning, wasn't he? No comment. If you could bear with me a mo, I have a statement here from a PC485 Coing. Again, this is taken from a computer, so it's not the original statement, but this was or deals with your subsequent arrest on the beach on the 8th of November 95, from which you were taken into custody. And you were taken into Ipswich Police Station. Do you recall that? No comment. And the tape is running, and I will explain that Mr. Roach has seen this statement. Yes, absolutely.
but I would also suggest to you that we've given you what we consider to be the fullest appropriate information at this stage. Under the Act, that's what you said. And now wish to give your client the opportunity to give his account of all these incidents. We're actually 38 minutes into this interview, and perhaps it ought to be an appropriate time, as you have raised it, as your client's disabilities, was the word you used, I'm not sure. Not at all, his own abilities. Well, you did mention in the custody room that Mr. Worms was dyslexic. That's right, yeah. Is that right, Jack? Are you dyslexic?
I am believed to be dyslexic.
Oh, you're believed to be dyslexic?
Yeah, I think I am dyslexic.
You think you are dyslexic?
I do have trouble expressing my words.
Have you had some form of treatment for this over the years?
No.
Have you ever been tested for it?
No, I've never been tested for it.
Have you ever been to a doctor's and expressed it?
No.
At school, did they not notice at school?
They think they noticed it at school.
So it was noted on your school reports and whatever?
Yeah. I had some definite reading and writing problems.
Right. But you understand normal conversation?
Yes, I understand, yeah.
You're self-employed?
I have a... engineer?
I have a job taking information on, yeah? I mean, you know, you've read loads to me and it hasn't sank in. And I'm the sort of person that, for this instant, if I take things... Well, we have done, Jack. But what we're actually doing is also asking a lot of questions. Short questions. Do you know Mickey Steele? Now, that has sunk in, surely. So what I'm saying is, if you don't understand something, then don't just sit there and tell us some months later, I didn't understand. It is now your chance. If you don't understand something...
I understand what you're saying to me.
So you understand things like,
I understand English.
When we ask you short, concise questions like, do you know Mickey Steele? You understand that question?
I don't wish to answer.
Right, okay. Okay. What I'm trying to define, Jack, is there's a difference between not wishing to answer and not understanding the question. That's what I'm trying to define, all right?
Okay.
And to clarify, I would suggest that yes, perhaps a fair amount has been read to you and spoken about. But I did clarify, did I not, that you were alleging, or we're alleging, that you are in cahoots. You are involved with Michael Steele in the importation of drugs into this country. I encompassed that, didn't I?
And I expressed it that...
Right, so there isn't anything that's unclear at the moment, is there?
No.
Great, thank you. Now, because we're 41 minutes into the interview, and we're changing the tape in a minute, this is a statement, as I said, PC Coeing. And it dealt with an event that took place on the 8th of November 95, in which he was arrested. It happened at 2:40 a.m. the Wednesday on the 8th of November. This PC went round about Felixstowe Ferry because it had been reported that three men were landing in a boat in suspicious circumstances. As we stood checking the vehicle, a man who identified himself as Jack Worms appeared from a slope running over the embankment and spoke with us. He said that the vehicle was his and he'd been out with the boat. Do you recall that?
No comment.
He explained that he'd been out on the boat with his brother John Worms diving and that the third person was Gordon. When further questioned, re the diving and said they had trouble with the boat, your brother John. Where does John live?
No comment.
It's strange that you said that the boat and vehicle were yours. Would you like to give any comment as regards to that now?
No comment.
Have you subsequently sold either the boat or the vehicle?
No comment.
Gordon. Who was Gordon, Jack?
No comment.
Do you know anyone called Gordon?
No comment.
Well, the man that identified himself to the PC later on was a Gordon Stevens. Do you know anyone by that name?
No comment.
Okay. Coincidentally, it goes on, and I'm not quite sure where you were at this time, whether you were still on the beach or what, but at 4:25 hours that day, I was present when a customs officer called Moore, that is, arrested Worms, Steele and Corey on suspicion of knowingly being concerned in the importation of a controlled drug. After caution, they made no reply. That's the tape telling me there's a few more minutes left. Again, I invite you to see if you can recall that now.
No comment.
I think it's an appropriate point now, because otherwise the tape's going to run out, that we conclude this tape at this time. Is there anything you wish to say at this moment?
No, thanks.
Jack, is there anything you want to say before I switch the tape off? Can I get you to sign the tape label? Jack, that's going to be used to seal the tapes up, just there.
Certainly.
Thank you, Jack. The date is still Thursday the 16th for the 5th, 96. The time by watch now is 13:18, and we're concluding the tape.